All my summer students who were in the reading classes that attended all four sessions, we went through four tests, which means they have 16 passage scores. We can use these to look for any possible patterns that might help your student get a higher score, or at least give them a better idea of what they need to be working on for the remainder of the summer as well as the school year. So we're going to look at three example sets of tests from a student. So looking at the screen right now, we have a student. You can see there are four tests and there are four passage scores on each of the tests. PF stands for prose fiction, SS stands for social science, H stands for humanities, and NS stands for natural science. This is the natural order of the reading test on every test. You can see that for this particular student, all of their passage scores are six or less. They've got some fives, some fours, and threes, but no high scores. The highest score you can get on a passage would be 10. So what does this tell us? Well, looking at this particular student, they have relatively low passage scores throughout all of the practice tests because, again, their passage scores are six or less. This is most likely because they don't have a strong reading base, which means they didn't read much growing up over the years. Again, most students now are part of that, the visual generation. They've grown up with TV, DVDs, cell phones, the internet. Reading is not as emphasized in school as much as it was, say, back in the 60s, 70s, and 80s when you didn't have cable television, you didn't have video games, and you definitely didn't have the internet and cell phones. So a student in this situation needs to build up their base. So what they need to do is they need to be reading on a daily basis in order to develop a foundation that will later allow the student to read faster and comprehend at a higher level. In my classes, I gave the students a bright green reading list of suggested books they could read. Okay, they really need to be reading at least 1 hour a day. Okay, that may sound like a lot, but that's only 7 hours in 1 week. There are 168 hours in a week. 7 hours is nothing. The reading is to focus on non-fiction material because this test focuses on non-fiction material. The more they read, the better they will do. One summer, I had 12 seniors improve their reading scores 7 or more points from April, the April ACT test, to the September ACT test. And when I asked them why they thought they improved so much, they said, most of them said, I just started reading for 1 hour a day, just like you said. I know it sounds simple, but it works. I had one girl, she improved her reading score from a 17 to a 29. That's a 12-point jump. Well, she decided to dedicate 2 hours a day to reading. She would read 1 hour in the morning and 1 hour in the evening. It made a big difference because she did it long-term throughout the summer. And that's the key. It needs to be long-term. It can't just be reading 1 hour a day for a week. This needs to become a daily habit for the rest of summer and the remainder of their school time in high school. It will not only help their ACT score, it will make them a stronger student in high school as well as in college. Okay, that was the first pattern. Second pattern. Here we have a student who's got a wide range of scores. You'll notice that they have some 10s, some 9s, and 8s, but they also have some low passage scores, 2s and 3s. And this does happen. I have some students right now in my summer classes. This happened to them. Well, the pattern is they have a wide range of passage scores. Really good ones. Again, 7 or higher is really good, and some really low ones. Probable causes. This is a student who probably read a lot growing up, so they have a really strong base inside them, but they probably don't read much now, hence the wide range. Well, this is a pretty easy fix. They need to dedicate time reading a variety of material, not just things they like, but things that they don't necessarily like or they're not interested in. That's why they have a wide range there. When a student's reading a passage on the ACT test that they're somewhat interested in, they focus more and they get a higher score. But if it's something that they're not interested in, then they're not really focused and they get that low score. We want to get, if they can get a 10 on one passage, there's no reason they can't get an 8 or higher on all of their passages. However, this will take some work. Therefore, they need to read a variety of material. Newspapers would be a really good source. Magazines would be a good source. Nonfiction books that contain a lot of short story parts throughout the entire book, which is Freakonomics and Outliers, those would also be good sources. The third pattern, do they have any passages that are always low or always high? You're looking at a set of scores. This actually happened to one of my students, where prose fiction was always his low score, but he was almost perfect, nines and tens on social science, humanities, and natural science. Okay, when this happens, then this may dictate the order the student wants to do the test in. For example, I had a student 1 year from Champaign Central High School. His name was Travis. Travis had taken the test twice as a junior, neither time finished the test. They would call a 5 minute warning while he was doing the humanities passage, and then he would not read the last passage, natural science, and then he would just do his best on the 10 questions. Still got a 26 both times on the reading test, which is a fantastic score, and he did that despite not reading the fourth passage. Well, he got a 30 on the ACT, and so he thought he was done with the test. Well, he started visiting colleges as a senior and realized if he got his ACT score up, then he would get more money in scholarships. Well, the only test he was having trouble with was the reading test. So in the fall of the senior year, I did my reading classes, and the reading classes happened to finish right before the October ACT test. And so when he was looking at his four test scores from class, he realized pro fiction was his weak area, but he was almost perfect, nines and tens on the other three. But he was concerned that, like on the October test, what happened the previous 2 years, he wouldn't finish the test. So he asked me what he should do. Well, I told Travis, I said, Travis, you've already figured this out. Okay, skip the first passage, do the next three. Okay, and that way, if you run out of time, the one you're not going to read is going to be your weak one, because then it really won't matter anyway. Well, as I tell my students in class, doesn't matter what order you do the test in. Yes and no. No, from the standpoint that the ACT doesn't care. They don't care what order you do the test in. But from a performance standpoint, it might matter. In this case, Travis knows his first one is weak. Therefore, when he's doing it, it's going to be a negative. And that negativity is going to affect the other three because they come after the first one. But if he would skip it, do social science, humanities, and natural science first, his strengths, he's going to feel positive, and he's going to go into the prose fiction feeling really good about his performance. It's no different than basketball. If you have a shooter who's having an off night for whatever reason, a smart coach will not bench him. A smart coach will run a play for him to get an easy shot in order to help him with his confidence. The ACT is a test about performance. It's no different than athletic competition, and our emotions will dictate how we do on this test. Well, when I told Travis that about skipping the first one to the next three, he looked at me and said, "I can't do that." I said, "How come?" He said, "You can't skip an entire section." I said, "How come?" And he goes, "You just can't." I said, "Travis, that's not a reason." And then he looked me in the eyes and said, "It's wrong." My dad is a pastor of a church, so is my father-in-law. It's not a sin, but I understood what Travis meant. Skipping a few questions here and there is one thing. Skipping an entire section is a whole different ball game. And Travis was smart. He was analytical. He was methodical. As students, we get in the habit of doing things in order no matter what. But as I told Travis, I said, Travis, if you do the same thing in October that you did as a junior and you expect a different result, that's a definition of insanity. The whole point of having students practice tests, taking AT multiple times, is to learn from them and then make adjustments and go forward from there. I told Travis, I said, you have nothing to lose. And Travis, you have already figured this out from practice. You just need to do it. So he decided to skip the first one. Here's what happened. He did social science, humanities, natural science, the last three passages, and he finished them early. So now he had extra time to apply to the prose fiction passage, and for the first time, he read all four passages. His reading score went from a 26, that's what he got both times in as a junior, to 33, a 7-point jump. His composite went from 30 to a 33, a 3-point jump in his overall score. Well, the October scores don't come back till about the second week of November. So by that time, Travis had applied to all his colleges. So right now, all he was doing was reporting his new ACT score. That was it. Everything else on his college application stayed the same. Well, the college he went to ended up increasing his scholarship package $40,000 because he got his ACT score from a 30 to a 33. This is why in class we are doing charts. We have charts for English, we have charts for reading, math, and science. So to help students self-assess their performance, to make adjustments for the next time. This is why looking at your patterns is invaluable. So as parents, Ask your students, do you have any patterns? Look at your scores. Help your student get to that next level. It really can make a difference.